Good evening, family. Good evening, good evening, good evening. I am Anthony Brown, Assistant Minister of Music here, as well as Creative Director at First Baptist Church of Glen Arden. And I am joined tonight by my amazing and beautiful co-host.
That would be me.
That would be you.
All right, everyone. My name is Barbara Holt-Streeter, and I serve as a community relations liaison right here at First Baptist Church of Glen Arden.
Well, that's her official title, but we know her as Miss Move Your
Body.
Come on now. You got to move your body.
Come on now. Y'all not ready for it.
Listen, she is Miss Move Your Body online, and tonight, that's a great way for us to get you excited. You're going to move your body tonight because Revival Day 2 is about to make you give God praise like you never have before.
Yes, and just in case you missed it last night, let me share a little with you what happened last night. So let me tell you all, Bishop Murphy talked about expectations.
Did he really? He actually lit the tent on fire. Not literally, but figuratively, he was so anointed talking about strategy.
Ooh.
And strength.
Ooh, now when I came yesterday, I was feeling a little,
Yeah.
But when I got that word and I started to do a little shout, because I don't know about you all. Some of you all haven't shouted in a while.
Oh, man.
Come on now. But this tent revival, you better get your shouting shoes on, heels, tennis shoes, or whatever, and get ready to shout.
Man, well, that was like last night. Bishop Murphy was amazing. We also had the amazing gift of Israel Houghton and New Breed.
Oh, my goodness.
That man just doesn't have a bad song.
No, and it took me back from years ago. I mean, people just stood up, and they did not sit down.
They didn't.
Whew, it was amazing.
They worshiped all night last night with him. It was really, really incredible. So listen, family, before we even give you a little bit of what happened last night, we want to actually encourage you to go ahead and push that share button. Share, because tonight's revival is going to be amazing, and we don't want any of you, our online family members, to miss it. So go ahead and hit that share button. And if you are posting about it, why don't you use our hashtag?
So we have two.
Yeah.
First one is FBCG Homecoming.
Mm-hmm.
That's FBCG Homecoming. And the second one
is FBCG Tent Revival. You got two ways to connect with us. And we already see you guys in the chat, lighting the chat feed up right now. In fact, why don't you tell us where you're watching us from? We would love to know where you're joining us from right now. We already got check-ins from California right now.
Oh, California. I think I need to visit California.
Yeah.
You know, COVID is a little slower down. I'm coming to see you, California.
Miss Barb, we also got Indiana checking in right now.
Come on, Indiana. Come on now. And look, as our minister said, share. Tell your friends. Tell your family. Call your sister and brother. Because guess what? We need you all to know what's going on at tonight's tent revival. Because this is night number.
It is night number two.
Come on now.
So before we get into what's going to happen tonight for tent revival, let's take a look real quick. Let's take a look back and show you guys through the miracles of modern technology what last night's tent revival was like on day one. Check this out.
We are in the camp. We are in the house. We are under the tent. We are together.
Bishop Murphy's recap was so hot that he broke the internet just now. I mean, he broke the internet just now.
Where's my fan?
Y'all see what happened? We came back late just now because Bishop Murphy broke the whole internet. He said by lunchtime tomorrow, which was really lunchtime today.
What were y'all doing
at lunchtime today? What happened? I just believe the man of God spoke a word over us.
Yeah.
And then lunchtime today, something amazing happened in your life. I know it happened in mine. How about you, Ms. Barb?
Oh, for real. And I see my sister's keeper said, last night was amazing.
Woo!
I love it.
Tina T said the enemy is upset right now.
Come on now.
Stomp him out. You know what it is? Lives are being changed. Yeah. This tent revival is not just some thing for us to get together and do. Lives are literally being changed, not just here in Upper Marlboro, but all over the world.
Yeah, and I can see now Stafford, Virginia, District Heights.
Yeah.
It is changing, and it's changing for the entire family.
It really is.
That's what we
so, family, let's get into tonight.
Come on now.
Tonight is another big night. It's night two of our homecoming tent revival, the triumphant return of FBCG. And we already told you the lineup tonight is going to be amazing. Ooh. Just to run it back one more time for you, Bishop Rudolph McKissick is preaching. He's bringing the word, and it's going to be amazing. And before he goes up, my brother, my little brother, he's a fireball for Jesus. His name is Kelontae Gavin. He's going to light that tent on fire again tonight.
Ooh, I can't wait to meet him.
Ms. Bob, have you heard him sing before?
I have. And I can't wait to meet and really engage with him because I'm going to ask him if I can be part of his next project.
Okay, so it's going to get awkward tonight on the pre-show.
Yeah.
So you guys don't want to go anywhere.
I'm just going to go out there and put my name in the hat.
It's going to get real uncomfortable or real good. We don't know which one. Tune in either way. But family, if you have any questions for Kelontae, I think we're going to bring him in to chat with us in a little bit. You might want to put your questions in the chat, and I'll do my best. I'll do my best to answer or ask those questions so you guys can hear his answers. He was actually, Ms. Barb, on my my last project, Second Wind, that I recorded here at First Baptist. He sung the title track with me called Second Wind. And if you've never heard his ministry, you need to get ready all over the world. This guy is literally one of our favorite voices in the kingdom right now and super, super anointed. So he'll be with us in just a minute.
He's amazing.
Get your questions ready in that chat. Do not forget.
Yeah, because again, as I shared, I'm going to ask him if I can be part of his project because my brother Anthony did not allow me to be a part of his project. But it's okay. It's okay.
I told y'all it was going to be awkward tonight, okay? Ms. Barb, here's the thing.
What?
You are probably the most bubbly, amazing person.
That would be me.
That would definitely be me.
That's me.
We're still turning up about this time tomorrow on your vocal ability.
Oh.
But it's coming. Tomorrow's coming for you.
Well, I can try. I can go ahead and audition.
Well, start with Kelontae, then we'll see how.
Come on, then. I can't wait to meet him. Come on.
Listen, family, our production team is over at the tent right now getting things set up for revival, which starts in just a little bit of time. I want you guys to see what they're doing. So I'm going to toss to Brandon, one of our production leads here at First Baptist Church of Glendarden. Brandon, we're coming to you.
Behind the scenes.
Hello again, First Baptist family. My name is Brandon Owens, and I am so excited to be here for night two of the Tent Revival. I am joined tonight by two members of our amazing, phenomenal production team, Nick Franklin and Matt Bowen. So, Nick, I have a question for you. What does it take to do production on this kind of level?
Oh, man, that's a loaded question. Well, as you see here, we're standing in front of our production tent, right? We have, where I sit, audio station, right? That's for online mixing. We have Matt here doing video directing. Katia in the background, if you can see her, she's doing the CG. Inside the tent last night, you guys saw our big old LED screen, lights, cameras. Basically, it's everything that you normally used to watching online, but just on a grander scale, a lot more equipment, a lot of more power. We're outside, you know, we have to run internet. It's a whole lot that goes into it, but, you know, we do our best to make it work. You know, we're a small team in number, but, you know, we do a lot around here, so.
Good stuff. And Matt, question for you. How did our team, let our online audience know, how did our team pivot during the pandemic?
Well, there were a lot of things we had to do. I mean, one thing we had to do was we had to change our sanctuary into basically like a virtual sanctuary. Just having the Zoom audience on screen so pastor can see the Zoom audience at home. And so they could actually worship with him and be involved with the worship experience as well. Along with that, we also just had to do a lot of things online as far as virtual choirs, showing those online for the services as well. And it just, we had to be a little bit more creative with our experience as well. It's a lot different from being in person to being online. So we had to be flexible and also pivot in a way in which we could bring the word of God to the masses, even while they're at home, in their beds, in their kitchens, or wherever they are.
Well, that is all the time that we have out here tonight. Thank you, Nick and Matt, for answering these questions. We're going to send it back to the studio to Ms. Barbara and Anthony.
Man, Brandon, thank you so much for that. You guys get to see a little bit of the hard work that goes into putting on an event this large and amazing. And we have one of the best production teams here at First Baptist, so shout out to them.
Yes.
But guess what, Ms. Barb? Guess what?
What?
I told you guys we would have a guest joining us, and that guest is right here, right now, none other than our brother and friend, Mr. Kelontae Gavin.
Really?
What's up?
Kelontae, thanks for being here with us, man. We're so grateful to have you.
Glad to be here.
We got it. Bam.
Hey, double dab. I got you. This is all. This is sanitized dab right here, okay? We done sanitizing everything. We all good.
Facts.
Brother, thank you for joining us here at First Baptist.
Glad to be here, man.
You are literally, again, one of our favorite people. One of our favorite voices, best personality, just super dope dude that loves Jesus. But tell our viewers a little bit about who Kelontae Gavin is.
Country boy from South Carolina. Shout out to man FBCG, man, everybody, man. I mean my start happened from the viral video in the school cafeteria.
So y'all remember that, right?
Like I remember
14
that.
Years old.
Yes, I
singing in my cafeteria. Cafeteria worker asked me to sing, and she records it, posts it on social media.
So she asked you to do that.
Asked me to do that.
And did she know you could sing?
She did. She did know I could sing.
Okay.
And then did she ask for backup? No. That wasn't my turn yet. I'm sorry.
Miss Barb, now come on now.
Okay, I apologize.
We talked about this.
We did.
Yeah. No. And she posted. Week later, life changed. Literally, my life changed.
Literally.
Wow.
Literally. So did you know the video went viral? Did you know?
I didn't know until like next week.
Wow. Yeah. So how did you know that it went viral? Did like
a family
your friends?
Member contact my? Matter of fact, I remember I came home from school and my mom. They was talking about it. Like, yo, family reached out and like you went viral. So, yeah.
Wow.
Literally. Yeah.
And that was so that began your whole musical journey career.
Love it. Yes, sir.
And now you are multiple projects in now.
Yes, sir.
Right? Two projects in?
Two projects, yeah.
Two projects in. His projects are amazing. Let's talk about the song No Ordinary Worship.
I'm just kidding.
That's
come
one of my
on, favorite.
No, listen.
Come on.
One of my favorite songs. Are you doing that tonight in the tent?
Yeah.
You are doing it?
Ooh,
y'all have to hear it a little bit later. Yeah. No Ordinary Worship. One of my favorite Kelontae Gavin songs.
Oh man.
Where'd that song come from for you?
My manager, man. Shout out Marquise Boone, man. My manager.
Wow. Marquise Boone wrote that song?
Wrote it, yep.
So your manager also writes?
And I didn't like it, absolutely.
And you
I did not like the song.
Well, tell us, why didn't you like it?
I don't know. I grew up more traditional setting, right?
Okay.
So churchy, Pentecostal, charismatic, all that, holiness, bam. I'm everything in one.
Gotcha.
But I'm more churchy. I just got into contemporary, maybe like 10, 11.
Gotcha.
We switched churches. Mm-hmm. Changed my life. I was like, I don't want to sing this song. He's like, you have no choice.
Well, here's the funny part.
Yeah.
Your worship is not ordinary. So it's very, very befitting.
Yeah.
We're glad you're going to do it tonight.
So
thanks for giving us a sneak peek into what you're going to sing.
Yeah.
Now, you've been here at First Baptist before as well.
Yeah.
You know our pastor. You know our First Lady.
Yeah.
You know our church family, right?
Facts.
But we haven't had you since the pandemic because the pandemic was going on.
Yep.
Right? So how have you been doing through the pandemic? How's that been going for
man,
you?
Man, taking it one day at a time.
Yep.
I mean, it's been a year for all of us. Yep. And,
yes.
Of course, taking it one day at a time.
Yes, sir.
A lot of people lost, but some people gained. All we got to say to God be glory. So, yeah.
Hey.
Oh, wait a minute.
Somebody
is crashing the set right now.
I have to bust in.
Yes!
Are you literally crashing the set?
I am crashing the pre-show.
Pastor Jenkins.
Hold up. And I brought some guests with me.
Who did you bring?
I brought the preacher for the night.
Oh my God.
Bishop.
Bishop McKissick.
Yeah, Rudolph McKissick.
So
hold up.
You, Bishop. I love it.
I want that too, Bishop. Yes.
Here is something we've never had.
Huh?
Also, oh Pastor Tim Story, who's also. Oh!
Wait a minute, y'all.
We got both.
I suddenly got crashed. Pastor Tim Story is here. He's preaching tomorrow night. He's not even preaching tonight.
It's going to be incredible.
But he came early.
He came early. He's my friend. That guy, I've known him for almost 30 years.
Oh, my goodness.
Yeah. He used to preach for us all the time.
He did.
But we got both of these guys here. I'm so excited about this revival and looking forward for Bishop tonight and Tim's Story tomorrow night. And y'all don't want to miss it. So wherever you are, you need to make your way to 3600. Oh, I'm sorry, 600. Or stay tuned in right on the website right here, all right?
Y'all can actually stay right there where you are. Don't go anywhere. Definitely go to 3600, like you said.
No,
don't go there.
That's
ain't
not the right place.
There.
No, don't go there.
The party
there.
Is all here tonight. We have Kelontae Gavin here. Our pastor just crashed the tent just now.
Woo!
He brought the preacher of the hour,
right,
who has his name on his shirt, so you know he's going to preach. You know he's going to be amazing.
Yes.
And even the preacher for tomorrow. It's all here at one time. You guys, Tent Revival is about to be crazy. I know these guys all have to go. Our pastor has to go. Me and Miss Barb got to go.
We got to get out of here.
Kelontae got to go sing.
Yeah.
So, Pastor, why don't you say goodbye to people? We're going to say hello to the tent.
Stay tuned. We'll be right back. We'll see you in a few. Hey, let's go to the tent. Let's go.
Worship in 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Welcome to Tent Revival.
All ye his angels, and let all people haven't made it, but you are still here. Come on, let's cry out to the Lord.
Amazing to us all. Oh, we sing out
your weapon. Hallelujah. Give God some praise because he is good. He is worthy to be praised. He woke us up this morning, started us on our way, and it's good to be in the house of the Lord one more time. Let's give God some praise. Praise him like you just don't care. Praise him like he brought you out. Praise him. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Glory to his name. Good evening, good evening, good evening. Welcome to the second night of the First Baptist Church of Lynn Arden's tent revival. Hallelujah. Glory to your name. I am Reverend Carolyn Tatum, and I am so honored to serve as your presider on tonight. Amen. If you would just take a moment to greet your neighbor. Now, you know we're not hugging right now, but if you would take a moment to say hello to the person next to you or behind you, say, good to see you. Glad you're here in the house of the Lord tonight. You could have been anywhere else on a Thursday night, but you're here in the house of the Lord. You look good, girl. You look good tonight. Good to see you tonight. Hallelujah. Praise God. Our scripture reading for tonight, our scripture is taken from Isaiah chapter 43. Isaiah 43, verses 18 and 19. This is our theme. That's Isaiah 43, verses 18 and 19. When you have it, say amen. Amen. Do not remember the former things, nor consider the things of old. Behold, I will do a new thing. Now it shall spring forth. Shall you not know it? I will even make a road in the wilderness and rivers in the desert. Amen. There is a blessing in the reading and the hearing of God's word. Amen. Amen. Let us pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, we come to you this evening just to say thank you, Lord. Thank you for allowing us to gather together with our sisters and our brothers one more time. God, we thank you for the online community. Everyone who has come online, oh God, to worship with us tonight, we thank you, Father. We pray your blessings upon this service on tonight, oh God. We ask that you would just speak through Bishop McKissick on tonight, that you would bless every word that is said, oh God. May it minister to our hearts and our souls on tonight, oh God. We pray, Lord, that you would bless everyone here. Lord, whatever they're standing in need of, that you would touch like only you can, that you would encourage, that you would lift up, that you would stir up the hearts of men. Open up our ears that we may hear what thus saith the Lord on tonight. We pray if anyone is sick, that you would touch them right now in the name of Jesus, that by your stripes they can be healed, oh God. We pray for healing of marriages and relationships, oh God. We pray for your healing mentally, physically, emotionally, oh God. We pray, oh God, for anyone that is mourning the loss of loved ones on tonight, that you would comfort their hearts like only you can. God, we're looking for you to do exceedingly and abundantly above all that we can ask. I pray that you feed us on tonight, that no one will leave the same way in which they came in. God, if anyone doesn't know you tonight, we ask that you would save, that you would deliver, that you would set the captives free. We ask that you would transform in the name of Jesus, transfigure, oh God, that you would speak to every heart that is here on tonight. Lord, we love you. We praise you. We pray for our pastor. We thank you, Lord God, for our pastor and our first lady. We pray that you would continue to bless them, their family, and the leadership of this church. God, we just thank you for another opportunity to gather in your name tonight. Bless this service from beginning to end. It's in Jesus' name that we pray and we give you thanks. Amen. 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 It is now time for our FBCG news.
Join us tomorrow, September 10th at 7:30 p.m. for our tent revival. Our guest preacher is Pastor Tim Story and guest artist, Pastor William McDowell.
Then on Sunday, September 12th and Sunday, September 19th, we're hosting outdoor worship services under the tent at 9 a.m. and 11:30 a.m. at the Worship Center. Finally, Sunday, September 26th, join us as we head back into the Worship Center. Join us at 9 a.m. and 11:30 a.m. We're also excited to host the first in-person communion service on the evening of Sunday, September 26th at 6:30 p.m. To get the latest details about our triumphant return, be sure to visit fbcglenarden.org/homecoming. Husbands, wives, join the couples ministry, Real Talk, Real Marriage, this month for a new and engaging series called The Satisfied Spouse. In this series, couples will learn how to avoid the common pitfalls that many married couples make that often lead to marriage discontentment. Stop waiting for tomorrow. Let's start living our best marriage now. Join us virtually Saturday, September 11th at 7 p.m. on the church's website or on Facebook Live at Real Talk, Real Marriage. Men, the huddle is back. We're helping you to move from striving to surrendering in order to help you win in the six core areas of your life. Join us virtually Saturday, September 11th at 10 a.m. You can watch on the church's website or Facebook Live. Ladies, are you ready for the He Loves Me Women's Conference? Join us October 1st and 2nd as we learn how to abide in Christ. In addition to inspirational worship services and virtual masterclasses, you get to experience general sessions that will be led by powerhouse preachers who are passionate about empowering women to be the best version of themselves. Pastor Pushy Watson is a grace girl from South Africa who's going to touch your life and give you hope. Pastor Donna Pisani leads Capital City Church, located in the Washington, D.C. metropolitan area with her husband, Dennis. She's coming to He Loves Me to inspire you to live a life of endless possibilities. We will also be joined by Dr. Medina Pullings, who has reached people around the world as an international conference speaker, preacher, teacher, television host, and CEO of Medina Pullings Ministries. Prepare to learn how to be steadfast in your walk with Christ. As always, you get to experience powerful praise and worship, enjoy fellowship with other Grace Girls, and much, much more. Did we mention this year's conference is hybrid, meaning you can attend in person at the FBCG Worship Center, or virtually? Be sure to tell a friend about this life-changing conference and register today at fbcglenarden.org/He Loves Me. That's the news for this week. You can find more details about these and other events at fbcglenarden.org.
Please govern yourselves accordingly. At this time, it is now time for our tithes and our offering. Amen.
Man, what an amazing way to start off. That was praise and worship.
That was just praise and worship. So just imagine, if that was praise and worship, I told you, get your stomping, shouting shoes on. It's just the beginning.
It is just the beginning. And now, family, it's time for us to give. You know, the Bible says, give and it shall be given back to you, pressed down, shaken together, and running over. That's what the Bible says.
That's what the Bible says.
And Barb, I don't know about you, but like, I've watched God do amazing things in my life because of giving. Tithing and giving is a big part of my life. How about you?
Oh, very much. I think I really started tithing and giving offering at the age of 10 when I gave my life to Christ.
Wow,
did not change. So having a business, I still tithe. Marriage, I still tithe. And God continues to bless and bless and bless. Because I know this, you sow a seed, you will reap a harvest.
Woo! Did you hear that? One more time.
Sow a seed, and you will reap a harvest.
And you will reap a harvest. And First Baptist, you are such amazing givers, both here in person and virtually all over the world. And we thank you for your amazing giving.
It's giving that allows us to do backpack drives that we recently did. It allows us to feed the hungry when no one was able to feed them. It allows us to have a vaccination clinic that we did over 2,000 per day.
Wow.
That's what it means to sow a seed and reap a harvest.
You know what? That sounds like a song.
Come on.
That might be your first single.
Lord, I know it was coming, y'all. I'm going to get on that project. I'm going to get on it.
Y'all going to get ready to hear Barbara Hall Streeter, Sow a Seed, Reap a Harvest. Come but on. In all seriousness, it's very, very true. And I hope you guys understand how important it is to give. And so right now, you can go to the button right there at the bottom of your screen. You can click Give there. And if you don't see that button there, you can always go to fbcglenarden.org/give, and you can give there as well.
Yes, giving does make a difference.
It really does.
And we really want you to take the time and be able to sow back into the ministry here. Because you know what? Let's be honest. It takes a budget to do what we're doing.
It does. To do what we're doing. It really, really does. But so many of you all in the chat right now, you all are testimonies, as well as me and Miss Barb, that God has blessed us in amazing ways. Not just financially, but when you give to Christ and you give to God, He blesses you in ways that money cannot buy.
Yeah. And look, we have North Carolina. Prince, hey, my daddy was from North Carolina. Look at North Carolina representing.
Yeah.
Who else do we have out here?
Man, it looks like DC's in the house. Upper Marlboro's in the house.
Oh, yeah.
And so while you all are giving, if you would allow me to, I'd love to pray over our offering moment.
Yes.
I think we can pray over this moment and ask God to bless our giving, even as you're giving online. So let's pray together. Okay. Father, thank you so very much for the way that you have always provided for us. Your name is Jireh. You are the God that provides. And even throughout this pandemic, God, in so many amazing ways, you have come through for us, not just financially, but Father, you have opened up the windows of heaven and poured out blessings that all of us don't have room to receive. Thank you for how you blessed our online community, our online members, and even those members here physically at the building. You are an amazing God. And so, Father, as we prepare to give to you, not to a person, but to you, we ask that you would take these blessings, take this 2 fish and this 5 loaves of bread. We lift it to you now, Father, and ask you to bless it and break it and feed the multitude of people who will be blessed by the giving in this moment. We thank you in advance for good news, and for a good report.
Yes.
In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen, amen, amen.
Amen, amen.
And you know, I'm looking at this fan and said, God is doing a...
a new thing. Well, where did you get that fan from?
You know what? Some of you all, if you may not know, you get a certain age as a woman, you get a little hot. So the fan comes in handy. Here, I'll throw you too.
That, you give me a little air too. I like that. God is doing a new thing. You know, that is the theme of our church this year, since you brought it up, that God is doing a new thing. It's from that scripture that says, behold, I will do a new thing. And you all are seeing right now in real time the new thing that God is doing here at First Baptist. The church is, it's the same location, but it's not the same church at all.
Oh, no, because so many things happened 18 months ago, 20 months ago. Just remember, back in March, all of a sudden we had to shift.
We did.
Or what the word everyone is using, we had to pivot.
We had to pivot.
But you know what? God kept on moving and blessing First Baptist Church at Glenarden. Pastor Jenkins didn't stop preaching or teaching. Anthony didn't stop singing. We kept on going. So now we're getting ready to continue to be a move of God.
And you know, more importantly, God didn't stop being God. That's the part that really blesses me. That even though we didn't stop doing what we were doing, God did not stop being God. He really did some things for so many of you all in the pandemic that really you have a testimony. Like, God blessed you even more in the pandemic than outside of it.
Oh, yeah.
If you have a testimony like that in the chat, I would love for you to give us a little high five. Let us know that God was still very much God for you, even during this pandemic. And I see you guys in the chat right now saying,
right.
I know that's
right. I know that's right.
He didn't stop being God, did he?
I love it. I love it. I have a friend of mine that owns a business. And during the pandemic, they opened the business and now have 17 employees. That ain't nothing but God.
Really?
Who opens a business during a pandemic?
During a pandemic.
Come on now.
Bought houses during a pandemic?
Houses. Yeah, wow. I see your hands. Come on now.
Hands are coming up.
Somebody said, Mike, drop.
Why you got your hands up? I'm going to toss it back to Stephen Hurd. He's in the tent about to introduce our guest, Kelontae Gavin, right now.
Call him like you need him. Call him because he's worthy. Come on, cry out to him and call him. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. I dare you to call him. Hey, hey. Hey. I dare you to call him. time I call the name of Jesus. You may have your seat in the presence of the Almighty God. I don't know about anybody else, but I smell smoke tonight. And where there's smoke, there's got to be a fire. I am so excited. I am so excited to introduce this young man that's coming before us tonight. His ministry really started at the counter of a cafeteria, singing to people about Jesus. And God has taken the purity of his heart, the sincerity of his heart, and the tenacity of his will to please God, and has breathed on it to such a degree that he's become a household name. He's an RCA artist. He has sung on Stellars and Doves and these award shows, but this young man has just really gotten his footing in the gospel industry, but there is a fire that's burning in him that is causing people to hear Jesus. And I need us to make some First Baptist Glen Arden noise for this young anointed gift. Kelontae Gavin, as he comes to bless us. Come on.
Hallelujah. If you love the Lord, feel the glory of God under this tent. Thank you, Jesus. While you're clapping real quickly, can we clap for the angels of this house? Pastor Jenkins, his beautiful wife, Lady Jenks, in her absence. Thank God for her. I've been a follower and a fan and a social media frenzy over the heart of the Jenkins family. Can we thank God for the Jenkins family? Just the family. Their grandchildren, the great, great, greats that's to come. Thank God for Bishop Rudolph McKissick, who's here, and Dr. Owens and Archbishop Owens. God bless you. I just met Pastor Tim, the preacher for tomorrow. The Tent Revival is, hey, y'all, I'm Kelontae. Y'all know me, I'm sorry. But I feel like we're family, but y'all know me, so I'm trying to do the first etiquette stuff. But I feel the glory of God. The tents are, it's an emotional thing for me because around 8, I received salvation not in a church building under a tent. They don't do these no more. They don't do these no more. It used to be a summer thing, and I'll never forget it. When I first met Jesus, it was being nosy in a musician corner, and something got a hold of me, and it changed my life forever. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Can somebody open up your mouth and glorify Jesus? You're wonderful. You're mighty. You are a great God. I need somebody that didn't come for a show tonight, but they came for the glory of God. Musicians, I need you to take 60 of my seconds, and I need you to lift up a voice right into your row. I'm going to tell you in 60 seconds what the Lord told me ironing my shirt earlier. And I believe it's getting ready to shift your life. The word is coming. But I believe as you lift up your hands under this tent, God is shifting something under your roof. And I need somebody to give him glory. Beginning and the end of the
there's a worshiper that says, I know he's God. I tried him for myself, and he never failed me. He never failed me. He never failed me.
It's so simple, but you got to help me sing. If you help me sing it, I promise you, we're going to lift Jesus up together. Y'all ready? Look at somebody, tell him God's been good to me all day. And I'm so glad about it. Hit that so great. Let's do great real quickly. I got my time to God. I feel God. Do me a favor. I need somebody, if you know he's great, can you let out a scream under this tent to say hallelujah?
There is no God like you.
If you're watching, you gotta help me sing it, okay? Simple song. Oh, it said, there's no name above Jesus' name. And throughout the land, we will now proclaim. Now we all can say that.
quick. Some of them said, look at me. Look at you and say, neighbor, great is not something he do. I'm country. You bring it. Make sure you paid attention. English people say, great ain't something he do. English says, great is not something he does. But say, neighbor, greatness is who he is. In other words, the Bible says, great is the Lord, and he's greatly to be praised. Which means if your praise ain't great, it ain't good. I need you to take another 30 seconds and give God the craziest shout you can give him. Let's go. Should we call you great? Great, great. In the morning, in the evening.
This is what he's getting ready to do. Say great, great, great. you. But if you got somebody that needs God in your family, I need you to give God an undignified praise, because where I am,
this ain't no ordinary worship. This ain't no ordinary song.
Tell him he's greater than cancer. He's greater than COVID. He's greater than diabetes. He's greater than depression. He's greater. I need somebody to open up your mouth and shout.
The Lord told me, I was out of my clothes, gotta go. Get that new network shirt ready. He told me out of my clothes. He said, you get there, you got one assignment. Tell them that their praise and worship is so magnanimous, has to be so big, has to be so crazy, it has to not match the situation that they're in. Tell them if they can give me glory under the tent, I'm getting ready to put glory under their roof. I need you to shout like you believe glory is getting ready to be under my roof. But you gotta watch it, she says, this ain't no. Yes, sir. Turn that track up there. Oh, oh, oh. This ain't no ordinary song. Yeah. The God I serve is greater than the ordinary. Anybody know that? So I'ma give him all I have.
Crucified.
to worship God. You've been a good God. Just a testimony. I'm lifting my hand because I don't have everything I want, but I got everything I need. He's more than good. He's been better than good. He said, David said, I once was young, but now I'm old, and I've never seen the righteous forsaken, nor received begging for bread. If you're watching, I dare you to lift up your hand. Yeah, and tell Jesus, you are good. This ain't no ordinary God that we're serving. He's extraordinary. You can be seated. What great worship. Thank you, Kelontae. How old are you? 22. 22 years young. Extraordinary gift. Thank you for coming tonight. Enjoyed having you. God bless you, buddy. Leading us to the presence of God. Hallelujah. Well, let me tell you something God did extraordinarily for me. I don't know what y'all be asking God for. Y'all, I don't know what y'all ask God for. But I asked God yesterday, Lord, if there's any way you can keep it from raining tomorrow last night. I don't know how y'all feel about that. See, that's the kind of stuff I ask God for, because he ain't no ordinary God. He can stop the rain. And I'm so excited again that y'all are here tonight. Thank you for coming. And guess who came tonight? This has probably never happened in the 32 years I've been at this church. The preacher for the next night came the night before. Come here, Tim Story. Y'all show Tim Story some love. I want to welcome him. Now, some of you newbies who haven't been at First Baptist any length of time, he used to come to First Baptist all the time. Blow on people and people fall out and
all that kind of stuff. And he's my friend, and he came tonight. And I want him to know most preachers don't do that. You look for a night. If you have a night off, you want to stay up in a hotel, sleep somewhere. But you came to worship with us. Thank you. We're looking forward to seeing you tomorrow night.
The main reason I came is because I'm hungry. No, but I'm hungry for a mighty move of God. I was saved at the age of 4, called to the ministry at 17. And I will tell you, I've never been hungrier to know him. And Jeremiah 9:23-24 says, thus saith the Lord, let not the rich man glory that is rich, or the mighty man glory that is mighty, but let him that glorieth glory in this, that he understands and knows me. So what a privilege to be in the presence of God tonight. Give the Lord a big, big clap.
Well, tell your neighbor, it's preaching time. It's preaching time. And we have a preacher in the house. I'm so grateful. So many things I can say. I've heard this man preach many, many times. And God works out miracles. When I first called him to come here to preach tonight, he had another revival preaching someplace else. And about 5 hours later, he called me back and said, you know what? I called that church, but they had decided to cancel the revival, so I'm free to come to you on Thursday night. Watch this.
Bishop Rudolph W. McKissick Jr. is a senior pastor of the Bethel Church, located in Jacksonville, Florida. Bishop McKissick has been afforded many national platforms to preach in arenas like the Hampton University Ministers and Musicians Conference, John Ellis Miles Jones Convocation, and was also inducted into the Morehouse School of Religion Board of Preachers. He's the author of several books, as well as an accomplished musician with several projects. Bishop McKissick also serves as a board member of the National Action Network, founded by Reverend Al Sharpton. Bishop McKissick Jr. holds a bachelor's degree from Jacksonville University, Master of Divinity degree from Samuel DeWitt Proctor School of Religion at Virginia Union University, and a Doctor of Ministry degree from the United Theological Seminary. He possesses an honorary Doctor of Divinity degree from both Bethune-Cookman University and Virginia Union University. Please welcome Bishop Rudolph McKissick Jr.
Please help me give a First Baptist welcome to Bishop McKissick.
Now that was good for me, but can you give God a great praise all up under this tent? Wherever you're watching, can you give God a praise? In your home, on your job, come on, I mean, shout unto God with the voice of triumph all over this place. Come on, this is the day the Lord has made. We will rejoice and we are glad in it. Take your seats in the presence of the Lord. Wow. I am always amazed at the ministry of this incredible man of God. Can you help me salute and celebrate someone I love and admire and respect? Pastor John Jenkins, so much admiration and respect and love for you, sir. Just an amazing man of God. Can you help me salute tonight, Lady Jenkins? Bless God for you tonight. So honored to see you again. And two of my favorite people in the whole wide world. I affectionately call him my bishop. Can you help me thank God for Archbishop Alfred Owens, co-pastor Susie Owens? I love my wife just got mad because they are in the house. That looks like my big brother there, Dr. Henry Davis. Is that, I can't see behind the man. Is that it? That's him. Dr. Davis, my big brother, so glad to see you tonight, First Baptist Highland Park. Pastor Story, I have followed for so many years, and to meet him tonight was just an humbling experience for me, and so honored, sir, that you are here. This young man, to God be the glory. Wow. Just absolutely amazed by your gift, son. I thank God for that. You're younger than all my children. I said, Lord, I'm getting old. And he said, 22. I said, I don't even have children that young anymore. I am just honored to be here tonight and humbled at this opportunity to share with you. I shout the love of my life out. She's watching. Next year, we would be married 30 years. She is still the love of my life. She's the executive pastor now of the church, and she is running things. And so I honor her tonight as she is watching Pastor Kim and my two favorite people in the world next to her, my mother and my father. They're both watching, and I thank God for Bishop McKissick Sr. and Lady Estelle. So, Father, now use me for your own pleasure. I seek no glory. I am an instrument who wants to be used by you. God, I do believe tonight that there is salvation, healing, breakthrough, deliverance, not only on the scene, but for somebody on the screen. Use me tonight. Have your way in me, with me, and through me. In Jesus' name. Amen. If you have a copy of the word of the Lord, go with me to the 5th chapter of the Gospel of John. My wife has gotten all excited. She texts me talking about, you're not praying with me. We need to do a tent. You see what you started, Pastor? I'm sitting down there in the Holy Ghost, and she texting me talking about, you're not praying. We need to do a tent meeting. All right. You're the executive pastor. Set it up. Set it up. The 5th chapter of the Gospel of John, and I want to begin reading at verse 1. Hallelujah. John chapter 5, verse 1. Hear the word of the Lord. Sometime later, Jesus went up to Jerusalem for one of the Jewish festivals. Now there is in Jerusalem near the Sheep Gate a pool which in Aramaic is called Bethesda, and which is surrounded by 5 covered colonnades. Here, a great number of disabled people used to lie, the blind, the lame, the paralyzed. One who was there had been an invalid for 38 years. When Jesus saw him lying there and learned that he had been in this condition for a long time, he asked him, "Do you want to get well?" "Sir," the invalid replied, "I have no one to help me into the pool when the water is stirred. While I am trying to get in, someone else goes down ahead of me." Jesus said to him, "Get up, pick up your mat, and walk." At once, the man was cured. He picked up his mat and walked. The day on which this took place was a Sabbath. I'll stop right there. Jesus said, "Get up." I like that old rustic King James. "Rise, take up your bed and walk." I want to preach tonight as the Spirit shall guide with this thought in our minds. I'm changing my choices. I'm changing my choices. Some years ago, a study was done that researched extremely successful people. Researchers were trying to find some link between all of them that would show what had caused all of them to thrive. They were trying to see if there was some one specific characteristic that was interwoven in the fabric of all of their experiences that could be the explanation for their success. They started with age, then they looked at gender and race, education, parenting, IQ, EQ, culture, nationality, relationships, opportunities, anything that would be a defining characteristic to confirm something similar in all of them to explain their successful path. What they discovered was something shockingly simplistic. They found that nothing linked these people. There was not one thing they had in common that could be attributed to their success. The only thing that they discovered in their research, and the only thing that their research confirmed from their interviews, was this simple and powerful attribute: the powerful influence of choice. Every one of them, hear me, every one of them, every man and every woman who were a part of the research in order to discover the secret of their success, use the power of choice to change their story. And their choice to choose changed everything. The power to choose who you want to be and how you want to live next to the power of God will be your most potent influence in your life. Your power to choose is a fundamental power of the human experience. Your power to choose has authority over all things. Yes, all things. See, God has a will for your life, and we know that's true, but you have to choose it. God's will is clear for your life in God's word, but God's will not be automatic until you choose it. Choice is very powerful in your life. Sometimes the choice is about looking at our most painful moments, our dumbest decision, our darkest areas where we felt wronged or did wrong, and making the choice to say, this will not defeat me. Sometimes you've got to make the choice, in spite of what you did or what was done to you or what is against you or what resource you may not have, and you have to make the choice. I don't care how rough this looks. I may be down, but I refuse to be out. This will not defeat me. You better hear that tonight. We have choices set before us each and every day. Moment by moment, we have choices, and the choices you choose can be the difference between your success and your failure. Because your circumstance doesn't make you a failure. Your choice to be defined by your circumstance is what makes failure. You have to make a choice. We see that at work in this all too familiar story here. Here we find Jesus at this pool of Bethesda. Pastor and I have had the privilege of visiting this pool on three different occasions. It's a large area with five porches, not all on the same level. It's situated right outside the temple so that people could purchase sheep for their temple sacrifice on the way into the temple. And the Bible declares it was filled with persons who were at the temple but could not have access to the temple because of their condition. Don't miss that. They were at the temple but could not have access to the temple because the rules of the temple did not let you in if you had a certain condition. And so they were outside the temple that was called the House of Mercy. And Jesus happens upon a man who the Bible tells us has been in this condition for 38 years. It's not clear if the 38 refers to his condition or how long he's been coming to the pool. But Jesus happens upon the man and asks him a pertinent question that I want to examine tonight. Now, we are given no insight into why Jesus chose this man among so many. The Bible gave a multiplicity of conditional descriptions of people who were at the pool. This is about to get good. And the Bible does not give us any insight as to why Jesus walked up and said, not you, not you, not you, not you, not you, you,
years. And preachers have offered all kinds of summations and suppositions and have always eisegeted into the scripture why Jesus chose this man. But the text never gives us a conclusion. All we know is that for some reason, Jesus picked him. You missed your first shout, and I don't have time to stop here, but while I drive by, I wonder if any of you can look back down the corridor of your life and see blessings in your life that you have no conditional explanation for. I wonder, is there anybody in the tent or in your house that can look down your life and see some things that have happened for you, and it wasn't your degree, it wasn't your money, it wasn't your connections, it wasn't your church. The only explanation you have is that the Lord picked me. I'm looking for the picked people tonight who can say, I still don't have a good explanation. I don't have an intellectual supposition. The only thing I can tell you is that the Lord picked me. Can I tell you tonight, sometimes the shout you give has to be void of intellect and just be, God, thank you that you picked me. I wonder, is there anybody tonight, I'm looking for you tonight, who can say, God, I'm just glad you picked me. I didn't have the degree for the job. I didn't have the money. I just want to shout, God, thank you that you picked me. Not that I'm better than anybody else. Not that I'm holier than anybody else. Not that I'm less sinful than anybody else. I don't even know why you chose me. I'm just glad you chose to choose me. I came by to tell somebody tonight, the Lord is picking you. He's picking every one of you tonight. I came to tell everybody tonight, not your neighbor. This ain't a turn to your neighbor. This is touch yourself and say, tonight the Lord is picking me. And if I make the right choice, I can get the right blessing because the Lord. Sit down. Sit down. He's picking me. He's choosing me. He's choosing me. He's choosing me. He's choosing me. And so Jesus walks up to him. And I want to examine this question that Jesus asked this man. Do you want to be made whole? Now the question seems to have an obvious answer. Because even the man's response has a yes, but in it. And Jesus was not trying to embarrass the man. Jesus was trying to empower the man. What you mean, Bishop? He's trying to get the man to get stirred in his empowerment. But here it is. But Jesus could not empower the man unless and until the man truly understood what was really holding him back. Come on. Here's what I love about the Lord. God is not just a need meter, but God is a need assessor. Y'all didn't hear what I just said. I'm mighty glad that the Lord doesn't just meet my needs, but every now and then he has to assess my need, because what I think I need is not really what I need. It's just really what I want. And I'm glad God doesn't always give me what I want, but he assesses what I need and then asks me questions. God knows what we need, even when we don't. So God comes through and assesses the need before meeting the need. And for some, it is like this man, getting you out of the stuck place where victimization has placed you. This is going to get mighty rough tonight. For some of us, Jesus, victimization has caused us to be stuck. See, most people, not you, and not you watching me online, most people don't even know they need to improve as long as they aren't in pain. Y'all not saying that, and I'll come back in 5 minutes. Most people don't even know they are stuck in suitability and settling for marginality because they are not in pain. They feel okay. And there are too many people who are managing managing pain but aren't pursuing purpose and have normalized abnormality. It's normal for you to be down. It's normal for you to be negative. It's normal for you to frown. It's normal for you to think it's not going to work. So here's how you know you have normalized abnormality. Because anybody you see smiling, you automatically think they're fake. Anybody you see giving God a praise, you automatically think they're showing off, because you have so normalized abnormality because you have been marginalized by your victimization. I believe the Lord laid this on my heart because I believe there are miracles with your name on them. Hold on, don't shout yet. That don't come to pass because we don't do the necessary partnering with Jesus with our choices. Yeah, nobody shout right there. If I had just stopped and said, it's got your name on it, there's a blessing with your name on it, you'd have ran all around the tent. If I had just hollered, it's got your name on it. But the reality is there are some blessings on hold in your life because you have not partnered with the Lord to make the choice to manifest that blessing. Everything this man did was a result of the choice he made. Now, I know this is going to get real sacrilegious for some of y'all. And Pastor Jenkins, I apologize up front. This was all about his choice. He didn't know this was Jesus. Uh-oh. Read the story a little later. When they asked him, what's up? He didn't really have an explanation. He doesn't know this is Jesus, so this can't be about his faith. Jesus never says to him, your faith made you whole. We know, he doesn't even know this is Jesus, so this story is not a supernatural healing in response to faith. Y'all don't like this now. Jesus never lays hands on the man. Jesus never asked him for a seed offering. Jesus doesn't place any oil on his legs. All Jesus did was give him a command to do something, and something in the man made the choice to do what Jesus said. And when he made the choice to do what Jesus said, something started to happen. I came to tell somebody tonight, if you'll just make the choice to do what the Lord said, some stuff is going to happen for you. And here comes your shout. The text said at once. I came to make an announcement. If you make a choice to just act on God's word, some stuff is going to happen suddenly. It's not going to happen next month. It's not going to happen next year. It's going to happen at once. Now, is there anybody tonight who can say, God, I need it tonight? I don't need it in October. I don't need it in 2022. I need you to do it tonight. Fix my marriage. Save my child. Turn around my business. Help me get out of debt. If you make the choice. See, sit down. Because choices help me control my story even when I can't control my circumstance. My choices matter in a season where I'm not free to choose a different story. But I can change the narrative of the story I'm already in. See, I've discovered when you learn to make the right choice, God ain't got to move you out from where you are. God can shift the narrative right where you are. God doesn't have to take you out to deliver you. He can leave you in it and deliver you while you're still walking through it if you make the choice. I'm in it, but I make the choice every morning. This is the day that the Lord has made. I choose to rejoice, and I choose to be glad in it. You've got to make the choice. Let me show you a couple of things. for this man's choice. There was what I call the prize of persistence. The prize. I'm gonna give this man some credit for one thing. He's been a survivor. Okay. I'm gonna help you because you didn't shout right there, so maybe I need to give you a definition of survivor. A survivor is somebody who continues to function in spite of opposition, hardships, or setbacks. Jesus. Let me say it one more time. I'm going to find all the survivors. A survivor is somebody who continues to function in spite of opposition, hardship, or setbacks. I'm going to say it one more time. A survivor. I'm going to find everybody that's going to audition for Destiny's Child and be a survivor. A survivor is somebody who has had hardship. They have had setbacks. They have had opposition. They have had things come over them, but they have not been able to let that thing keep them from being an overcomer. It's somebody who keeps going in spite of everything that's against them. And I am a living witness that God will give you power to function in the hard places of your life. Do I have a witness tonight? You ought to say it to yourself right now. Come on, this ain't a turn to your neighbor. We got CDC regulations. You ought to say to yourself right now, I am not a victim. I am a survivor. Come on, don't let that mask mute you. Shout. Say, I am not a victim. I am a survivor. I function in setbacks. I function in opposition. I function in hardship. I thrive in difficulty. I stand in hell. I smile in struggle. I praise in problems. I walk through trouble. I am a survivor. I'm a survivor. And because I'm surviving, eventually I will be a victor. Here's what I love about this man. 38 years. I don't know if that's how long he's been sick or how long he's been coming to the pool, but we know this ain't his first rodeo at the pool. But what I love about him, Dr. Davis, is every day he shows up and it doesn't go his way, but he keeps coming back. Every day he shows up, it doesn't go his way, but he keeps coming back. Every interview he has, they call him back and tell him they went with somebody else, but he goes to another interview. Every doctor he went to, they told him they couldn't help him, but they went to another doctor. Y'all ain't said. Every bank they went to, they told him they couldn't give him the loan, but they kept going to another bank. Because when you know that you are a survivor, even when you can't catch a break, and you seem to go from one failure to the other, and people you thought had your back are the ones selling you out. Nothing you do seems to work for you. Bills are out of control, and then others come in you forgot about. Job laid you off. Pay got cut. Health got challenged. Family's acting crazy. Friends walked away. But the reason you can shout is because with all of that against you, you keep on coming back. You keep on surviving. You keep on going. I wonder, is there anybody tonight? Everybody ought to shout in this tent, because for 18 months, the devil thought he would take your joy. The devil thought he would steal your faith. The devil thought you would fall out of love with church. And yet here you are giving God praise, because after all you've been through, you are a survivor. I need all the survivors to holler. I need everybody that knows you keep on coming back. You keep on making. I need you to holler. Sit down. I got two more times to tell you that. That's why some people don't like you. because they counted you out last year. Woo! And yet here you are still giving God glory. That's why folk on your job can't stand you. They thought you were going to quit last year, and yet you working from home and didn't resign because you're a survivor. I'm trying not to get happy because I know that from experience. When that doctor told me I'd never preach again, when that doctor told me I'd never sing again, when he told me my vocal cord was gone for good, I said the devil is a liar and God is exalted, and I am here today hollering to the top of my lungs because I am a survivor. You've got to refuse to be defined by your difficulty and keep on showing up. Let me show you something else. Let me show you something else. Second thing this teaches me about the choice in the text, you need a dream and a plan. Okay. When you read the man's response to Jesus, it's obvious to me that the man hasn't stopped dreaming, but has just started excusing. I know he's still dreaming because he says, I don't have anybody to put me in the water when the water stirred, which means every day when he goes home and it didn't work for him, he has to reimagine the dream in order to come back the next day. See, the reason the enemy wants to take some of y'all's dreams is because if he can steal your dream, he'll steal your endurance. If he steals your dream, he'll steal your tenacity. The man is still dreaming. I think he's still dreaming. He's showing up. Here's his problem. He's showing up, but he's not showing up with expectation. Oh, God, this is going to get good. He is showing up wishing, hoping, and supposing. Like some of us do when we come to church. We don't show up with the spirit of expectation. You sit there hoping the praise team will move you. Wishing the preacher would holler so you could get your emotion on. Supposing if somebody else was preaching, you'd get your word for tonight. Because you have no spirit of expectation. He's dreaming, but he's excusing. If you read the text, he had a dream, but Jesus had a plan. Jesus didn't lay hands on him, snap his fingers. I told you that already. Didn't wipe his sweat on him. None of that stuff. Jesus said, if this gonna work, I'm gonna give you a plan and you gotta work the plan. Don't worry, we're gonna shout for it's over. See, people know how to dream, but sometimes they don't know how to translate the dream into an action plan. I'm trying to help somebody. Because dreams don't become reality unless and until you work towards them becoming so. No matter how hard you wish, is it any wonder? You throw all your money on an altar, sowing a seed after the sermon, and you go home and still in debt 3 months later because you had an emotional response but never had an action plan. You listen to some preacher lie about the next 25 folk that stand up, you getting out of debt tomorrow. And you stood up and hollered, and a year later, you're still in debt. Because you had no plan. Nobody wants to talk to me. Hear me tonight. I'm trying to help somebody. Wanting something isn't enough. You can't get off whatever mat you're on without a plan. You cannot get off the mat of debt without a plan. You cannot get off the mat of divorce without a plan. You cannot get off the debt of bad business practice without a plan. Whatever mat you are crippled by needs a plan. Because without a plan that alters your daily habits, nothing changes. I know. Here it is. Don't worry. We got one more and we're going to shout. Most people don't create plans, Bishop Owens, because they are too in love with the dream. The dream is alluring, and the dream is exciting, but you got to fall in love with the process as much as you are with the dream. It means you got to find peace with the struggles and peace with the frustration and power in the setbacks. It means you got to overcome all the excuses you make for why you can't. Then it hit me, y'all. It hit me. The man had a plan. He just had the wrong plan. He had a plan. Get a man strong enough to take me to the water. Wait till the water's troubled. Be the first one in there. Here's how you know he no longer has expectation. Because if all you need is a man and you don't know who Jesus is, he's a man. Why you didn't ask him? How often is your miracle in your face through somebody God sent to you, but because you are so stooped in your excuses, you don't even see the blessing God put in your face? All Jesus did was give the man an alternative plan, and when the man followed the plan, he got the power. He got the power to do what he had been dreaming of doing. He got the power to do what he had not been able to do. He got the power to do what he thought he needed somebody's help to do for him. Here it is. If you follow the plan God gives you, God will give you the power. Because here is the goal: to never have to wait on anybody else to do for you what you got the power to do for yourself. I wish I had somebody who could say, God positioned me so I don't have to get a cosign. I don't have to drive a car in nobody else's name. My house is in my name. My bank account is in my name. I can get up and smile because I love me. Give me what I need. God's trying to empower you to take your destiny out of other people's hands, to stop waiting for somebody else to participate before you live powerfully. Look at the text. Jesus didn't call for some men to help him to the pool. Jesus didn't even offer to stay with the man to get him to the pool. Jesus said, if you do what I tell you to do, you'll never need the pool again. I came to tell some of y'all, you got pool addiction. Whatever your pool is, whatever you've been depending on, whatever you think you got to have for you to make it, God said, I sent McKissick all the way from Florida to tell you, if you follow my plan, I'm going to cut you off from some stuff you thought you had to have in order for you to be successful. Rise. Take up your bed. Whoa. The man said, I can't do that. I ain't got nobody to help me in the pool. Here it is. You ready for this one? You can't get accustomed to your crutches. One author says that too many Christians live in what he calls the messy middle. It's messy because you know too much to stay naive to the plan of God in the Word of God, but you're too dependent on your old habits to live powerfully in the plan of God. Come here, let me say it one more time. You know too much to act ignorant to what God wants you to do, Jesus, but you're too dependent on your old habits to have enough trust to do what God calls you to do. So you live your life in the messy middle. You know what God has called you to do, but because you're scared to try it, you stay in a messy middle in your life. You know God has called you not to shack but be married. You know God has called you to have godly friends, not your work friends, but you live in the messy middle. This man's problem was he had adjusted to his 2x4 foot mat norm. Huh? They say those mats were about 2x4 feet. And he had adjusted his life and shrunk his value to fit Jesus into the mat he was on. Because if you decide to adjust to your crutches, you will shrink yourself down to fit in to the small place you've decided to stay. And he went through the same routine every day. And while it seemed monotonous, it was safe. But you can't get a miracle staying in safe space. Woo! The man gave his excuse because he had grown accustomed to his crutch. Hear what I'm about to tell you. Miracles cancel criteria. Come on, I'm going to teach it before we preach it. See, we set criteria that has nothing to do with what God is able to do. And the reason we miss out on miracles is because we box God into our criteria. We let our logical assumptions trump our theological beliefs. Preach, Rudolph. So before we know it, our reality is defined by human assumption rather than divine revelation. He assumed he had to have a man. He assumed he had to see an angel. He assumed the water had to be troubled. And because he had criteria that had nothing to be with God, he didn't believe he could do it without all those things being in place. And how many of us set criteria that has nothing to do with God? But when God comes along, Jesus said, oh, you got it twisted. This ain't about water. This is about walking. And to do what I'm telling you to do means you got to cancel all of your criteria. As a matter of fact, sometimes your assumed criteria becomes the stage on which your miracle is set. Because when everything you thought you had to have ain't in place and God still works the miracle, the only person you can give credit for is God. God and God alone. Is there anybody I'm talking to who can say, I got some stuff and I can't give credit to nothing I thought I had to have? I had to say, if it had not been for the Lord on my side. I'm done. Last thing. I'm sorry. I'm trying to help you. Here's the last thing. When you make a choice, here's what it shows me. You can't do everything, but you can do something. I thought that'd have shouted you. You can't do everything, but you can do. This man couldn't do everything. He couldn't bring himself to the pool. He couldn't put himself in the pool. He couldn't do everything. But the command of Jesus shows him he could do something. Take up your bed and walk. As a matter of fact, if you want to get out of the victim game, start by saying to yourself, I can't do everything, but I need to do something. I can't do everything, but I just can't sit here if I'm going to get the miracle in my life. Here what it is. Do what's in front of you to do. Rise, Jesus. Take up your bed and walk. I'm finna shout somebody. The only way way you can rise is if you get strength in your legs. Y'all gonna miss it. It didn't say he was an invalid from birth. It says he was an invalid for 38 years, which means his legs haven't always been broken. Something happened in his life that caused his legs to be broken. So you know what Jesus was saying? If you follow my instructions, you're going to get back something you lost, and it's going to be better than it's ever been. And that's my shout to somebody tonight. You got some stuff you lost, and you don't think you can use them anymore. But God said tonight is the night where you get it back. You lost your joy, but tonight you get it back. You lost your mind, but tonight you get it back. You lost your praise, but tonight you get it back. I know you can't shake your neighbor's hand, but look them in the face and tell them, neighbor, along this journey, I've lost some stuff. Some things the devil took, some stuff I messed up. But the Lord showed up under the tent called Bethesda to let me know that tonight I can get my legs back. I can get my joy back. I can get my peace back. I can get my mind back. I can get my family back. I can get my child back. I can get my faith back. I can get my finances back. I can get my song back. I can get my smile back. I want you to air high five somebody. Don't touch them, just air high five them. And tell them, neighbor, tonight is the night where you get it all back. Everything you need, yes, to be who God called you to be. Everything you need to get your miracle, get it back tonight. Get it without any help. Get it without any struggle. Get it without any man. Get it without any woman. Get it without any preacher. Get it without any offering. Get it without any dance. I got to go, y'all, but I can't leave you. He said, rise, take up your bed. There ain't but two ways for you to take your bed up. You got to bend down, or you got to bow down. Because I've discovered if you bow down, you can pick up some stuff. Bow down, yes, is the posture of worship. And if you become a worshiper, you've got some stuff that you can pick up. Good night, First Baptist. May the Lord God bless you real good. But is there anybody in here that can help me close this sermon? Stand on your feet, because you got your legs back. Give God a shout, because you got your legs back. And I believe tonight, when somebody walks out of here, you gonna thank your legs or your joy and say, thank you, God, I got my joy back. And I want you to do me a favor. I'm not gonna tell you to walk around inside this tent, but right where you are, pick one leg up and then pick the other up. And then let your legs be anything that you lost. And then tell the Lord, Lord, I thank you that I got it back. Lord, I thank you that you restored my mind. Lord, I thank you that you restored my peace. Won't he do it? Won't he do it? Won't he do it? Won't he fight your battles? Won't he make your enemies your footstool? Won't he give you joy in sorrow? Won't he give you hope for tomorrow? Won't he dry your tears? Won't he, won't he, won't he, won't he, won't he? And because I know I got it all back. Because I know I'm better than I've ever been. I got to
praise tonight, because I know for myself, if you work the plan, God's got the power. If you work the plan, God will lift you up, because I discovered a long time ago that God will give it back to you. I told you, a doctor told me I would never preach again. My vocal cords were paralyzed, but then one day I leaned on the Lord, who is able to do exceedingly and abundantly. And you could think, pick your legs up and say, I got it all, I got it back, got my joy, got my peace, got my mind, got my soul, got my family, got my marriage, got my dance, let everything that has breath, open up your mouth and pray. Shout like you got it back. Holler like you got it back. Scream like you got it back. Jump like you got it back. Run like you got it back. Walk like you got it back. Let everything that has. With a choice to change his choices. Tonight, there are some of you who are in several categories. For some of you, during the pandemic, you made the choice. The church wasn't for you. See, I've been home. I don't need the church. I need you tonight to make the choice to change. Because you can't get off that mat by yourself. It takes somebody speaking a word to you that you choose to respond to. How can they believe in him in whom they have not heard? How can they hear without a preacher? Some of y'all need to make a choice. Maybe you're home tonight and you have participated a bending ear, but you're like this man. I can't be saved. I can't be in the church. Watch this, because I have no man or woman to put me in the pool. Jesus said, that don't take all that. Jesus said, I didn't include a pool in my plan. If you confess with your mouth on the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, he didn't say you'll be saved when you get to the pool. Thou shalt, it's a present tense indicative, right now. And all I'm gonna pray tonight
that you make. I'm sorry. My wife and I are in the most blessed years of our marriage, 30 years next year. It ain't because I've been the best husband. I've made some dumb and stupid mistakes. My marriage survived and is better than it's ever been because I made a choice. Anybody lay hands on me and speak over me and made a choice. We make spiritual things so spooky. And we have not yet figured out that it is simplicity, not profundity. It ain't nothing profound. It's a choice. We make it so spooky. You got to go to the right conference and you got to be in the $1,000 line. And I believe in seed sowing. God knows I do. God's given me a gift for it. I'm not knocking any of that. But none of that matters if you don't make the choice to change. And I, Pastor, tent revival, I want to preach one of them good old-fashioned get up and holler, scream throughout the sermon. I did. I wanted to do that. But God wouldn't let me. God said, no, I'm not sending you there to do that. You ain't going there to impress nobody. They know you. Go there and preach what I told you to preach. Because there will be people under that tent and on the screen who have normalized and become satisfied with their mat because they think their excuses justify their marginality. And tell them tonight, make the choice, and they'll get back what they lost. I want to pray tonight for some of you to make the choice for salvation. I want to pray for others of you tonight. God, I feel your Holy Spirit to make the choice tonight. I'm saved, but I don't have a church. I'm saved, but I'm not connected. I'm saved. You know, we use all this neo-Pentecostal. We got all these new terms. I'm not under a covering. I need a covering. No, you need a church. I mean, you know, we get so deep. I need a covering. You need a church where you can grow your faith. You need to be a disciple somewhere where you can mature in your faith, and you need to make that choice tonight. Tomorrow is not promised. Come back tomorrow night as a disciple to get a great word from a man of God, but don't come back tonight talking about I'll do it tomorrow night. You don't have tomorrow. I want you to make a choice. Never accepted Jesus Christ. I'm like the man. I've been outside the church, but I thought I couldn't have access to the church. Those are excuses. Make a choice tonight. I want to be in a church, but man, Glen Arden is too big. It's as small as you want to make it. I hear that excuse all the time from people. I want to join Beth, but it's too big. It's as small as you want to make it. If you make the choice, God will introduce you to an intimate circle right in a mega church. It's just a choice. For some of you tonight, your choice is not about salvation or discipleship. It's about some things in your life. Make the choice to fix your marriage. Make the choice to change your spending habits. Get out of debt. You're not going to get out of debt sowing seeds, but then you go spending everywhere. Make a choice. Make a choice to try to open the business again, even though it has failed every time you try. Tonight, that's just simple. Make a choice. This wasn't that deep. This wasn't this man's faith. He didn't know this was Jesus. It was a choice to just trust what he was told. And if you just trust what you're told, you'll get up, and whatever your legs are that you lost, you'll
stronger than ever. So I want to pray tonight. And Pastor, you'll tell them the instructions. But I want to pray that you make a choice. And so God, tonight I have honored you. I have done what you sent me here to do. I didn't come for shouts and for runs. I came tonight to challenge some people to change their choices. So God, tonight there's somebody watching me, and there's somebody even under the tent who doesn't really know your son as their Savior. God, there's somebody here tonight who met your church but didn't meet your son. And now they don't want anything to do, because sometimes your church is harder to love than your son is. They've walked away, but tonight, help them to make the choice to fall in love with your son. Somebody's never confessed your son. They confess they go to a church, but they've never confessed salvation by faith. They're watching me on the screen tonight, and they wanted to cut off because the sermon was over, but something has them waiting. Somebody under this tent, God. And I pray tonight that when the instructions are given, they will do like this man. Stop their excuses and just follow instructions. For somebody else, God, they're saved, but they are on the mat. They've gotten lazy in their discipleship, lazy in their faith, satisfied with where they are in their faith. But tonight, you're calling them to make a choice. And I hear in the Holy Ghost, there are some people in this audience tonight who have been in the pew, but they've never been in a ministry. And God, tonight, help them to make a choice to use their gift to edify your name, to grow the kingdom through this church. And for others that need to make choices in areas of their life, forgive us for our crutches. Forgive us for our excuses. And help us make the right choice. And when the instructions are given, God, help us to do it immediately and watch the blessing unfold in Jesus' name. Just turn to three people and tell them, make a choice tonight.
Praise the Lord. What a great challenge tonight. What a great word. Make a choice. Your choices will put you where you are or take you from where you are. Somebody needs to make a choice now. If you need the Lord Jesus, make a choice to get out of your seat and make your way up here and say, you know what? I want the Lord Jesus in my life. I want to get saved and get right with God. Make that choice. Somebody's backslidden. You need to make a choice to rededicate yourself. Come right now. That's right. I see. Somebody else right now, right this moment. This moment, this instant. Backslidden. You need to rededicate yourself. Somebody else, you need to rededicate yourself. Come right now. You're unsure. You need assurance. Come right now, right this moment. That's right. Come right now. I see you. Come on. That's right. The angels are shouting and dancing with every person that comes. That's right. Somebody else. You're unsure of your salvation. You want assurance. Come right now. Or you need a church home. Come right now. You fall in. I'm proud of you, young man. How old are you? You 52? You look like a teenager, man. I'm proud of you. Hi, sweetheart. Come. Hi. How are you? How old are you? Huh? 13? I'm so proud of you.
Anybody else tonight want to come? It's all in your choice. What a great word tonight. It's all in your choices. Go ahead, sing it now. Go ahead and sing. Make the choice. Let's pray. Father, thank you for these souls that have responded to the gospel. Pray that their faith would be extended to you, that you would give them and move them and place them where you've called them to be. Save, forgive, restore, plant, whatever their need, grant it, we pray. Fill them all with the power of your presence. In Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. Come on and give the Lord a shout of praise for these souls tonight. Let's thank the Lord for Bishop Rudolph McKissick, who preached like a wild man tonight.
I surrender all to you.
Yes.
Everything I give to you. Withhold nothing. Withhold nothing. Oh, withholding nothing. Withholding nothing. Wow, family, I'm telling you, I feel the presence of God so strong. Miss Barb, do you feel what I feel?
It's the choice. Exactly what the bishop said. It's a choice to surrender your life. It's a choice to make a difference.
Absolutely.
It's a choice to say yes to God.
It is.
And you out there now, it's never too late to say yes. It's never too late to give your life to Christ. It's never too late to turn things around. It is never too late, regardless of whatever age you are.
Absolutely.
It's never too late.
Absolutely.
Right here as we're looking online, you can hit the button to say, I commit. You can raise your hand to say, I commit.
Yes.
I'm ready to surrender. I'm ready to give my life to Christ. Just like we did.
Yes.
I did at the age of 10. When did you give your life to Christ?
I was 7 years old when I gave my life to Jesus. It was the best decision I ever made in my life.
Yes.
And like Miss Barbara's telling y'all right now, I'm telling you, there's no greater decision that you can make than to give your life to Jesus Christ.
Yes. Yes.
You know, Bishop McKissick was saying tonight, talking about choices. And I want to just remind you, I want to double down on what he said, that you're literally one choice away from your life being changed forever.
Yes.
Giving my life to Jesus was the best thing that ever happened to me. It does not mean, and Ms. Barb, we could talk all day about this.
Yes.
It doesn't mean that everything just automatically becomes perfect and roses. No, trials still come. But I'd rather be in the trial with Jesus.
Yes. Yes, yes.
Than in the trial without him.
Yes. You know, Bishop mentioned he's been married for 30 years.
Yeah.
And so I am so blessed. I met my husband here at First Baptist Church of Glenard, Malcolm. And it'll be 15 years in December.
Wow.
And let me tell you, the day we came back from Hawaii from our honeymoon, I was crying in the driveway. because I was ready to go back home to my mom and daddy. I said, what choice did I make? But I heard God said, this is the choice that I made for you. And so when I sat back and I said, God, you allowed me to connect with this man, that Malcolm Streeter, that's the best choice. Well, I think it's the best choice he made. How about that?
Best choice he made. The man to find a wife.
But oh my goodness, the choices that we make are life-changing.
Listen, this is your opportunity online. As Pastor just gave the appeal inside the tent, we just want to come remind you once again that Jesus is the best decision you could ever make. There's a commit button. Or even if you're in the chat right now, you can raise your hand and say, listen, I want prayer. I'm not sure. I'm backslidden, and I want to recommit my life to Christ. Or I want a dope church home. How about this? This is the new thing that God is doing here at First Baptist. You don't even have to live here in the area. You can join us virtually from wherever you are in the world, and you can be just as much a part of our church family from wherever you live. And so I just want to give you time. I believe God is moving on somebody's heart even right now. Even right now in the chat, I believe he's moving on your heart. And for every worshiper that's watching, if you could just join me in this declaration. I surrender all.
Yes.
I surrender all to you.
Yes, yes.
Everything I give to you. Yes. Here's the part. Withholding nothing. Oh, withholding nothing. Lord, tonight. We withholding nothing. Oh, withholding nothing. Song says, I give you all of me. 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 It's one of my favorite parts. Let me tell you why. That part right there, Miss Barb, is so important because so many of us struggle with giving ourselves to Jesus Christ because we think we have to get it all together before we come to Jesus. But let me and Miss Barb tell you ourselves, you can't get it all together before you come to Jesus. In fact, you need him to get it all together, and even when you get him, you'll still be broken pieces. But he's able to take those broken pieces and put you back together again. I don't know about you, Ms. Barr, but isn't that your testimony?
It is. Let me tell you, there was a time that it was at Costco. Y'all know about it. If y'all have a Costco in your area, and I pulled out the debit card, and guess what? There was nothing on there.
Come on.
I didn't have money to pay gas, but I drove around thinking that I look good, but you know what? It was a woman behind me said, sister, I'm going to pay your gas. And I said, thank you, Jesus. And what did I do next time I was at the gas station? I sowed a seed and I paid for the next person's gas. And so when we talk about giving your life to Christ, God can change things financially for you.
Hallelujah.
That you don't even know how and when to begin. But you have to be able to say, God, if I put one foot, just one.
One foot.
God,
one
you
step.
Want to just continue with me. And
absolutely.
Continue and continue and continue. And God will show you things that you never, ever imagined.
Yes, he will. Yes,
I remember
he will.
A few years ago.
Tell me.
Anthony had a testimony.
I did.
It was a financial testimony. And why the number 17,000?
That's what it was. You remember that?
I know.
That?
I remember.
Wow.
I remember. Won't you share it?
You know what? It was just an obedience move. You know, sometimes God will test your obedience and have you jump out there and do something you never thought you would ever do. Some of y'all, you know this. Have you ever been in church and God tells you to sow a seed and it's like the largest seed you've ever sown? And it's a faith walk to trust God in that moment. But I did, Miss Barb. I trusted God in that moment. And when I tell you God gave me back that blessing, pressed down, shaken together, and running over, that's an obedience thing. But in order for you to hear God and trust God to that magnitude, you have to be his child. You have to accept him into your heart. And so for those of you all that are watching right now, I want to pray that prayer of faith with you right now. So many of you all in the chat, we're watching you. Raise your hand and say, you know what? I want Jesus in my life. Some of y'all may be unsure, or you may be in the valley of decision about a church home. Let us just pray over you even now that God will arrest your heart and help you to have the faith and the confidence to make the best decision you'll ever make.
Yes.
So stop wherever you are with me real quick, real quick. Come on, I need faithful believers right now to join me in the chat.
Yes.
Because I believe God is moving on the behalf and on the heart of somebody who's watching right now.
Yes.
And I want you to know that there's no distance in the spirit. In fact, where we are right now, God is. And where you are right now and at home, no matter where you live, God is right there with you. I feel his presence and power right now, even in the studio.
Yes.
And I know he's moving on your heart. So let's just pray the prayer of faith. Father, right now in Jesus' name, we thank you right now for moving on the hearts of your people all over the world. Thank you that you're proving yourself that you are the true and living God, that there's nobody like you in all the earth. Thank you, God, that one day you touched my heart. One day you touched Miss Barb's heart. One day you pricked our hearts in a way where we wanted you in our lives, where we cried out, what must I do to be saved? Tonight, Father, somebody's watching online. We can feel them right now in the spirit. Somebody's watching online, and they need you in their life. So, Lord, as an act of faith, as they stretch their hands, even in their home, I ask you, dear Jesus, to come into their hearts. Help them, Lord Jesus, to pray the prayer of faith with me, that we are sinners and that we need you in our life. We don't know how to do this thing without you, and we desperately need you. So we lift our hands and cry out for you to come and live in our hearts. We thank you, Lord Jesus, that we confess with our mouth, we believe in our hearts that you are the Savior, the true and living God. And we believe by faith that if we confess with our mouths and we believe with our hearts, that you will come and live in our hearts and be our Father, be our Savior, be our Lord, our Redeemer, and our soon coming King. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for saving somebody's life tonight. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for recommitting yourself to them and them to you, for making your connection even the more strong. And thank you, Lord, for those who are even deciding tonight to join with our FBCG International family. Thank you for testimonies tonight of good news and good report that are on the way. And we give you praise and glory for it all. In Jesus' name we pray and give thanks. Amen. Amen. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Hallelujah.
Amen.
I believe.
God. Amen.
Woo.
Amen.
I feel his presence even now.
Yes.
And you can even sing the part with me. Just, I give you all of me.
Woo.
I give you all of me. Yes, Lord. I give you all of me. I do, I do, I do. And your life will never be the same.
Yes, 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 yes.
Your life will never be the same.
Yes, yes,
I
yes.
prophesy over you. Your life will never be the same.
Yes,
Jesus
yes,
is
yes.
with you. Jesus is with you.
Yes.
He's with you.
Yes.
Withholding nothing for you. Withhold nothing. We encourage you tonight. Withhold nothing. Oh, withholding nothing. I hope you were blessed by that moment just now. I could do that all day, Miss Barb, because I just feel Jesus in the room.
I know I was. You know, God spoke to me when you were just sharing.
Yeah.
And when I said I've been married, it will be 15 years in December. Let me tell you something. Yeah. I didn't get married until I was 40, y'all. 40.
Wow.
So the single woman out there that is watching, it is never too late.
Hold on, Ms. Barb. How you got married at 40? You only 20.
Come on now. That's what I'm talking
21.
About. Yes. Yes.
Y'all look
yes.
at her. She ain't nobody. Man, get out of here. Get out of here.
40.
Listen, you know what you got to do that? You got to be a sower. What did you say earlier, Ms. Barb?
Ooh, sow a seed and do what?
Reap a harvest.
Come on now.
Listen, Bishop Rudolph McKissick preached a mighty word tonight. We've been chewing on it right now. We've been talking about it with you all. It's all about a choice.
It is.
I'm praying right now that you will make the choice to sow into the man of God's life. You know what the Bible says? That if you give to them that sow, give to them that give like that, that God will add increase even to your house. And so real quick, even on your screen right now, we're going to put up his Cash App. If you feel led to sow into his life, I'm going to sow into his life, Ms. Barb.
I know I am.
Because I believe that if
yes.
I sow there, that's good ground. You know,
good
you sow
ground.
Where the ground is good.
Good ground.
So I believe his Cash App is up on the screen right now. Let's sow into the man of God's life.
Yes.
I just believe, there it is right there
yes.
on your screen. I think you should go to Cash App right now. And if you believe God for a harvest from that word, you should sow a seed.
Yes, yes. And the Cash App is R-U-M. McKissick Jr. That's R-U-M-C-K Jr.
Don't forget that money sign.
That money sign for Cash App. Come on now.
Put that money sign up and then type in R-U-M-C-K Jr. and you can sow into his life.
Yeah, look on the chat. Yeah. It says, I'm so here for the sowing.
Whoa.
I love it. I love it.
Come on, starring Maddie D.C.
Yes,
I'm here for the sowing. Absolutely. Many of you all who have sowed seeds have reaped amazing, amazing harvest. And thank you for the testimonies in the chat. We see you right now. There's also a link at the bottom of your screen if you need prayer. Listen, this church is a church that believes in the power of prayer. We know that prayer changes things. There's a request prayer button at the bottom of your screen. Even if you just want somebody to pray for you, we are here for you.
Yes, yes, yes.
We're here
and
for you.
And sometimes you have to realize that prayer is not, don't feel like you're all alone. So this is the time, because of COVID, you probably needed prayer even more. So this is a time, request for prayer, because our ministers, our evangelists are here and ready to pray with you. You're not alone.
Absolutely.
You're not alone at all.
Absolutely. Family, tonight was incredible. How about that Kelontae Gavin?
Woo!
Come did I tell now. You? Did I tell you, Miss Barr?
You did.
I told you the boy is bad. He's cold blooded.
Yeah.
He walked in that tent, grabbed the microphone, and shut that thing down. I felt the wind of God all through his singing.
Down. And he started at the age of what?
He started when he was like 14. You guys knew his testimony. We talked about it earlier tonight.
Yeah.
He was singing in the cafeteria at his school, and he got discovered right in that moment. The video went viral, and God has blessed his ministry since then. And so thank you, Kelontae Gavin, for joining us. Y'all follow him on social media as well. His name is Kelontae Gavin. And also follow Bishop Rudolph McKissick as well. But tonight, as we're closing, we have a special guest. I'm going to make room for him even now as he's coming. He bombarded us earlier.
Yes.
But tonight, he's joining us on purpose. It is our very esteemed pastor, Pastor John K. Jenkins Sr.
Hey, hey, hey. Thank y'all. Thank you for joining us. And I hope you really were blessed by that message and the whole ministry tonight. Galante, man, that young guy, 22 years young, is amazing. And I'm so proud of him, so grateful for his passion and his energy for the things of God. And the message from Bishop McKissick about choices. Choices. What messes most people up are the choices we've made. Have you ever made a choice in your life and later you said to yourself, now what was I thinking? What in the world was I thinking? And he just laid it out there that this man who had been paralyzed for 38 years had to change his choices. And I wonder what kind of choices you need to change. What kind of decisions do you need to say, you know, I need to do something different. But thank you for joining us tonight. I want to thank our team here, Anthony and Barbara, for their hosting tonight. And
so we're glad to be here with you.
Yeah, we're very honored.
I wanted to ask you a question that somebody asked earlier in the chat about this tent revival. What made you want to do a tent revival to begin with?
Yeah.
Well, you know, I've been wanting to do a tent revival for years.
Mm-hmm.
And what has always held me back was the cost. And so once I evaluated how much it would cost, I said, wow, it's just too much. But with us being out of the building all this time, and it's been a yearning that I've been wanting to do for many, many years. I'm so grateful. And I may see if, I don't know how long we're going to have this land available to us, but we'll probably try to do it again next year. Because I love tent revivals. I love the tent. I grew up doing that, preaching under the tent. I love it.
So you wanted to do it for a long time, but you made a choice this year.
That's what I was going to say.
You made a choice.
I caught that. I remember back in the day when we had tent revivals, and back over at the old ministry center, we would walk. I mean, you talking about excitement to be a part of that, the community. And I felt that. I felt that yesterday. I felt that today. And can't wait until tomorrow.
Tomorrow, right?
Yeah.
Well, Pastor, thank you for your obedience. The last two nights, tonight included, somebody has walked down that tent aisle to give their life to Jesus Christ.
Amen.
And if even if it's just one person, do you believe that the whole thing is worth it if just one person?
Oh, it's worth every dime. It's worth every dime.
Yes.
So I don't regret it.
Yeah. God is doing a new thing, and he is changing lives right here under the tent revival.
We have one more night of revival, guys. If you thought last night was something, you thought tonight was something, you do not want to miss tomorrow. Once again, Pastor had our guest preacher, Pastor Tim Story. He was here with us tonight.
Yes.
Which you said was uncommon for them to come.
Yeah, it's uncommon for any preacher, you know, sure. to go into a city a day early and attend that service yes, to which you're ministering. True. So I honor him for his humility. Yeah. And he's a friend. I've known him for many, many years, and I appreciate him coming and being with us tonight. But he used to come to us and lay hands, and people got healed.
Ooh, I remember that.
He did all kinds of things. But anyway, yes. I'm looking forward to his ministry tomorrow.
Absolutely.
And you don't want to miss tomorrow night, 7:30.
And we'll also have Pastor William McDowell. His music ministry will be here with us as well tomorrow night. And so you just don't want to miss that. In fact, we're going to show you a little bit of it before we leave tonight. But Pastor, you want to say goodnight to all the people before we push to the video?
Good night, and thank you for joining us. And thank y'all for being a part of tonight. God bless you. We pray God's richest blessings on you. Thanks for being with us.
From our pastor, from me, and from Miss Barb, thank you so much for joining us. And we will see you tomorrow. Check out this video right now.
Good night.
Join us tomorrow, Friday, September 10th at 7:30 p.m. for our Tent Revival. Our guest preacher is Pastor Tim Story and guest artist Pastor William McDowell. To get the latest details about our triumphant return, be sure to visit fbcglenarden.org/homecoming.